Hello, I'm Ann Johans. I'm an Extension Program Specialist with Iowa State University Extension and Outreach, an Ag Decision Maker. And joining me today is Kevin McClure with USDA Farm Service Agency, going through a brief overview of the 2023 election and enrollment process for Iowa producers under the 2018 Farm Bill. So Kevin, Iowa producers have had to make decisions under this current Farm Bill for several years. We've had these same programs, and so we're pretty familiar with them, but it's still good practice to consider the best option, right, for any given farm as we go into 2023. And so what do producers need to take into consideration or decide ahead of that March 15th deadline?
Perfect. Well, thank you, Ann. Really good questions. And there is, with being the last year of the Farm Bill, when prices where they're at, there are decisions to make. And so we still need to, producers need to go through this process and make sure that they get the election they want on the farm, and you still have to complete that enrollment process. So today I'm going to quickly go through the kind of an overview. Producers pretty much know what the programs are with regards to PLC, ARC-CO, ARC-IC, but I've got a little brief overview of those, and then really hitting home, how do we take care of that process? And I've also got a little bit of what the current marketing year projections are, and then what the, for PLC, kind of what that reference price is. So we'll kind of go through, I've got about 17 slides here, and we'll go from there. With general provisions, what we have, of course, there's the election process. And producers have done this process since 2014. There is an election currently on the farm that was made either in 20 or 21, 22. We were able to make changes, or producers could make changes to those elections starting in 21. 23 is the same process, that if you don't like the election, you can make that change. If it was PLC, you can go to ARC-CO, ARC-CO back to PLC. Producers get to make that election process. If not, current elections on the farm remain, and now we're going to take care of the enrollment process. And so producers will let us know who has a share in those base acres, and then those producers will be completing contracts and getting signatures by a deadline we'll mention here in a minute. Both processes are completed on the same contract or same form, so it's not like we need multiple signatures on multiple forms. So that's a very nice change. The deadline to complete both the election change and enrollment for 2023 is March 15th of 2023. This March 15th deadline has been put in play with the 18 Farm Bill. It's worked really good for us, because that's that same date as what crop insurance has for completing insurance changes for their policies. So any change in the election could be made up through that deadline. I will stress, however, no changes to an election can be made after that deadline. We can take what's called late file enrollments, but the elections must be decided by that deadline. Payments, if calculated for 2023, were always a year after the fact, because we go with that marketing year. Say for corn and soybeans, that's going to start September 1st of 23 and goes through the end of August of 24. So that's quite a ways out. But again, those projections are made as we go month by month. Here's just some real quick general provisions. Producers pretty much know about these as well. There's eligibility and payment limitation provisions. We do have that actively engaged in farming cash rent tenant. There is an adjusted gross income of $900,000 that's required. Of course, you're highly erodible. WC, 1026 provisions, foreign person, and then the pay limit is $125,000 per person. So with our sign-up process, and with COVID over the last 2 years, the county offices have learned how to work with producers through that email process. There's a lot of different ways to contact the county office now. We can send contracts via email, and they can be encrypted. We can use box one span. It's really slick. Producers then can take care of any signature requirements locally at home, send those back into the office, and they're good to go. You can also contact the office and ask for contracts to be mailed to you. Let them know what the shares are, the producers that have an interest in those base acres, and then contracts can be mailed. Obtain those signatures, send them back to the county office by the deadline, and you're good to go. Of course, always we can contact, the producers can contact the county office. We really encourage making an appointment if you have a large number of farms, because then folders can be pulled and then it will be ready for your appointment to be able to take care of that process. But again, probably the easiest is that email or mail. Biggest thing there, again, is just contact the local office to see what they're able to get done for you and those things mailed out and should be good to go. So we're going to talk about the program election. And so basically, as I said before, producers can make a change to that election. Again, there is a current election on the crop or farm from last year. If the producer likes that, nothing needs to be changed there. However, we still need to complete the enrollment process that we'll talk about here in a little bit. If you do want to make a change within the election, then we need all producers with an interest in cropland are required to sign. Zero share landowners do not have to sign for election changes. We've made that change back with the 14 Farm Bill. Makes life a lot simpler and easier to process. Elections are locked in for 2023 only. Again, we've got a new Farm Bill coming starting in 24. And if whatever program is put together at that time, the election would not be stuck with that particular farm or base crop at this point. If no change to the election, if the producers don't want to make or request a change, then the 22 election remains. But again, we do need to complete that enrollment process. So quickly, I just took a quick screenshot. This was as of December 5th. As you can see what those marketing your average prices are currently projected. You can see corn is $6.80 and soybeans are $14. So we've seen a huge rise in producers going ARC-CO because PLC has those lower reference prices and is price oriented versus ARC-CO and ARC-IC is both yield and price. So quickly, the election options, price loss coverage, or PLC as we call it, it's price-based. We use that marketing year average, and we reference it back to a reference price set by Congress. And if it's below that, then it triggers a payment. Our ARC programs are more revenue-based. And I look at these similar to a crop insurance product where you have a benchmark, you calculate a guarantee, and you compare that to the actual revenue of a yield and a price. So it's very similar to how an insurance product works. With the ARC programs, we've got county level or ARC-CO as we call it. That is straight county level yields. Those are determined through RMA, starting with the 18 Farm Bill. ARC-IC is an actual individual producer yield. And so producers do turn in yields for those. Those are done by farm, and then we weight revenues, and I'll show that in just a minute. The note here is extremely important. RMA's SCO, or supplemental coverage option, product is not allowed if either ARC options are elected. So that's why it's really important. If you decide as a producer you want to use that SCO product with your crop insurance agent, then make sure that you don't have an ARC election on that particular crop in that particular county that you're working with. So, because we don't catch that information. That's all done on the crop insurance side through RMA. So price loss coverage, again, price driven. We take an effective price, the marketing your average price, just as I showed previously, if those became final at $6.80, let's say, that's what we would compare back to a reference price. We pay on 85% of the base acres. It can be elected by base crop. Again, it does combine together with that SCO product. And then payments are made regardless of planting the covered commodity. So here's those reference prices. So as you can see, corn is $3.70, soybeans is $8.40. So with that projection back in December of $6.80 and $14, currently PLC would not trigger, and PLC is not triggered for 21. We just paid last October, and we had no PLC payments issued for corn or soybeans. So again, watch those MYA prices, and you know what the national reference prices are for those particular crops if you're looking at going into the PLC or changing to PLC. The ARC products, just like I said, are more of an insurance. They mirror an insurance type program. With ARC CO, we basically look at if the actual revenue is less than the guarantee, which is 86% of the benchmark. We use county level data for that. Alejandro's got a very nice tool out there. We also have all of this data posted with regards to what the benchmarks are calculated at currently for your crop in your county. And then the guarantee is calculated there too. And I'll show you where you can get that information in a little bit. So basically payments, the payment rate can be no higher than 10% of the benchmark. If there was a huge loss, say that the yield was extremely low in a county and that triggered a payment and a large payment, we're not going to pay any more than 10% of that benchmark revenue. Same as PLC, 85% of the base acres are paid on. And again, with ARC CO, you do not have to plant the covered commodity to get a payment. So, and the election's made on base crop by base crop, just like PLC. ARC IC is just a little bit different of a program. It is individual yield based. It's similar to ARC CO, except we use individual producer yields for the farms that are enrolled and elected into the ARC IC program. Iowa does not have large numbers at this point. Last year, I think we had about right around 1,000 farms that were enrolled. So not a large large participation, but it does work very well for certain farms, and producers have been very happy with the product. Payment rate is a difference between the ARC IC guarantee, just like we did with the ARC CO, and we look at the actual revenue for the year. In this case, it would be 23, and we have that 10% cap as well. If prices were extremely low and your yields were low enough that it calculated a large payment, there is that cap. Payments are made on 65% of total base acres, because what we do is we weight those revenues across crops that are planted. And in this case, covered commodities do have to be planted, because that's how we calculate those actual revenues as to what you plant. So if you plant all corn, we calculate corn revenues. If you plant corn and beans, we calculate both sets, and then we weight them depending on how many acres are planted of each of those crops. So that's a quick overview of the programs and the election. Now we'll hit enrollment. Again, the enrollment deadline is just like the election change. It's March 15th. Again, it's done on the same form. Producers can elect PLC and or ARC CO using an 866 form. And then, of course, ARC IC, since it is the entire farm that goes in, we do that on an 862. Producers requesting a share of the base acres sign those applicable contracts. Again, zero share landowners are not required to sign, so we've made that a lot simpler and the process a lot more streamlined for producers to complete and take care of. Again, it's up to producers to decide if they want to participate or not participate, farm by farm, and you can go from there. So here's some of the decision tools. This is our link to our website that has all of the yield data. It's got the benchmark revenues. It's got what we've paid in the past. It's a very good site to go to take a look at past data, past history. What have we paid on? And then what are those 23 current benchmark prices and yields? Again, with prices being where they're at, we have not made a lot of payments over the last couple of years because of those prices being high, and yields have been average to above average. So the ARC CO is not triggered and PLC is not triggered. So the program is working somewhat, it's basically working the way Congress had intended, And if prices are extremely low, then these programs kick in. Or if yields are extremely low, then these programs kick in. So a very good website with a lot of good data. And then the final slide I have here is with regards to the tools. Ann and crew with Alejandro and Chad, it's an awesome ag decision maker tool that they have out there. They pull in all of the benchmark data, and it's a very nice, simple tool to utilize. I like it. Texas A&M has a decision tool. Also, the University of Illinois has a decision tool. So there are three really good tools for producers to use in making those decisions here over the next few weeks before March 15th. And with that, Anne, that's really all that I have for a quick update for 2023.
That was wonderful. So I am curious, just off the top of your head, you mentioned there's about 1,000 farms in ARC-AC. Do you have a rough breakdown of what the enrollment was last year between ARC-CO and PLC for the state?
Yeah, approximately we had about 65% go ARC-CO on corn. The rest went PLC, and that was due to that SCO option. Yep. Because if producers want to take that SCO, then yeah, they have to, even though they know they're probably not going to get a payment if prices are high, they still have to have that election. With regards to soybeans, that percentage is a lot higher. It's closer to probably 85 to 90% is in the ARC-CO, and then the balance is in PLC.
Okay. But I'm just curious, and we know mm-hmm. that those payments were pretty minimal last year, but just something to keep in mind if you want to compare yourself to the state, and definitely for those that are considering that SCO program, that's when they really want to be looking at that decision differently. And so yep. Thank you, Kevin, for joining me today with this update. I appreciate hearing directly from you on what those Iowa producers need to consider in these coming weeks, and to hear, you know, how they might interact with those FSA offices. And so I know every situation is unique, and so we need to make the best decisions right for our farm operations. And so if people would have further questions, our farm management specialists are prepared, and you know they're definitely available to answer those one-on-one questions. We just know that decision's maybe a little bit easier to make this year than it has been in past years. And with the new farm bill, we're going to hit the ground running and have, you know, more intense and much more programs across the state, those in-person programs, more webinars, that sort of thing in next year. But for this year, I think this is going to be perfect to help answer some of those questions. And so just know that as you're watching this, any of the links shared in this PowerPoint, we're going to have in that description. We're going to have another video that covers the tools more in depth, and just know that those resources are available for producers making decisions this year. And so with that, we're going to close out our video. Thanks so much, Kevin, for joining me.
Thank you. Appreciate it.